Okay, welcome everybody. We're on the book of Ezra, and we just have finished learning it, so it was suggested to make a summary. So we'll try to do it within about an hour. We'll see if it works, I'm not sure. And for those who have learned it, so it'll be like a review. For those who haven't learned it, so it'll be a preview. And if someone doesn't plan on learning it, it'll be at least be a summary to know in general what the book is talking about. So the Gemara says that Ezra is the one who wrote the book of Ezra, and Ezra Nehemiah, the Gemara says it's considered one book, and the count is 24, so that's considered one book, even though the Gemara says Nehemiah did write Nehemiah, but it's all called on Ezra's name, and eventually when we get to Nehemiah, we'll say what the Gemara says about that. But Ezra is the author of Ezra, and he's going to be introduced first in Perek Zion. He's not introduced in the sequence of events until Perek 7, but he wrote from the beginning until the end, it seems. And then Nehemiah took over and wrote the book of Nehemiah. He also wrote Dibri HaYomim. Part of Chronicles was written by Ezra also. The Gemara says in Sanhedrin that if not for Moshe Rabbeinu, then Ezra would have been the one to give the Torah. It means he was so worthy that it would have been possible to give the Torah through him, if not that Moshe Rabbeinu had preceded him. The book of Ezra finds us between the first Golos and the second Golos. Between the first Beis Hamikdash and the second Beis Hamikdash, this is the end of the Golos of 70 years. The Pasuk says that they knew ahead of time that there's going to be an exile for 70 years after the first Beis Hamikdash till the second Beis Hamikdash. There was going to be a lapse of 70 years. But there are two Pesukim that the Gemara says seem to contradict each other. One of them says that it's a 70-year count from Bavel, from Malchus Bavel. That after Bavel has ruled for 70 years, I'm going to reckon you, take reckoning of you. Another pasuk says that there's from the destruction of Yerushalayim. But Bavel, Babylonian Empire, started before the destruction of Yerushalayim. So the Gemara says that there are two counts, two ways to count 70. There's, just to map it out, there's 18, 52, and 18. And you can count the 70, the first 18 and 52, or you can count the 70 from the 52 plus the 18 afterwards, which means that from the kingdom of Bavel until the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash was 18 years. And then there was a 52-year exile that the Eretz Yisrael was empty. And then in 52 years after the Chorban, after the destruction, that's when Koresh, we're going to see now in the first pasuk, he permitted Am Yisrael to go back and build the Beis HaMikdash. But they didn't build the Beis HaMikdash until 18 years later, as we'll see as the story unfolds. So you can count 70 two ways. You can count from the beginning of the Malchus Bavel until Koresh, which is the Persian Empire. So the Babylonian Empire was 70 years. And you also can count it from the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash, which is 18 years later. It started 18 years later, and it ends 18 years later, because they didn't build the Beis HaMikdash until 18 years after Koresh came on the scene. So those are the two counts of 70. So we're holding now when Koresh, Am Yisrael was in Persia. They were taken through Golos Babel, and then after three kings of Babylonia, he had Nebuchadnezzar, and then he had a son, Evil Merodach, and then he had a son, Belshazzar. Those are the three kings of the Babylonian Empire. And after Belshazzar, he was assassinated, so then Dariush and Koresh took over. That's the Persian Empire. And our Novi starts, this book of Ezra starts in the first year of Koresh. Dariush was the king first. A couple of years, doesn't say how long, I'm not sure if it says the second year, maybe, three years. It wasn't a king for very long, maybe 2 years, I think. Mm-hmm. And then Koresh took over. So the pasuk starts over that in the first year of Koresh, the king of Paras. I'm not going to translate everything because it's only trying to be a synopsis, but just to get the general idea, that Koresh was aroused by Hashem, and he made an announcement in all of his kingdom, and it's written down, that so says the king of Koresh, the king of Persia, that all of the land, kingdoms of the land, Hashem, has, the God of heaven, is giving to me, and he commanded me to build a house in Yerushalayim, in Yehuda. So he said he was commanded to build a Beis HaMikdash. And the truth is that it's mentioned by name. He was mentioned about 150 years earlier by Yeshayahu, the Navi Yeshayahu. He's mentioned in the Pasuk. The Pasuk says about the king who's going to be a King Koresh. And he was prophesied that he's going to be the one who's going to bring back Am Yisrael. The Gemara says he didn't do a great job because he should have told everybody to go. He just says he gave them permission. He said, whoever wants to, may. And he should have done better. But he did give permission to anybody that wants to go, from the Jews can go, as he says, who amongst you from all of Hashem's nation, Hashem should be with him, and he should go to Yerushalayim, which is in Yehuda, and build the house of Hashem, who is the God, in Yerushalayim. So the main thrust of the pasuk was he wanted to build a base of Mikdash. We're going to see that there's the building of Yerushalayim, which is after the base of Mikdash. The book of Nehemiah is mostly about the building of Yerushalayim after the base of Mikdash. But the first issue of Korosh was to build a base of Mikdash. And he said, whoever wants to go may go from the Jews, and anybody that's not going should give money, gold and silver, and property, animals, and donate to the base of Mikdash of Yerushalayim. And the leaders of the people, and the Kohanim, the Levim, and whoever else was aroused to go, they went. And all the surroundings also supported them and enriched them with silver and gold. Also, Nebuchadnezzar also permitted them to take out the kelim that had been confiscated by Nebuchadnezzar 52 years earlier by the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash, and they had taken all the vessels of the Beis HaMikdash and brought it to Babel and put it into their temples. And Koresh now permitted them to take it back, and he appointed somebody in charge. His name was Shesh Batzar. There's a question if that's his new name, we don't know who he is, Shesh Batzar. Later on, we're going to see he was appointed a governor. He had an official position, a Persian position, to be governor of the Jews. And some say he might have been Daniel or Zerubbabel, but the Pshat doesn't say. It might be that he was another personality, we don't know. His name is Shesh Batzar. And then the pasuk lists all of the kelim that they took back, gold and silver, and they brought it. And that was the first aliyah. This is going to be the first aliyah going back from Babel to Yerushalayim.
And this is 42 years?
52. 52 years after the destruction.
They brought the kelim from Babel.
Nebuchadnezzar had brought them from Yerushalayim to Babel, and now they were giving them back and told take it back from Babel back to Yerushalayim. To put it back in the base of Mikdash. Build the base of Mikdash and hear all the kelim. It doesn't say about the menorah and the mizbeach, that it doesn't say, but it says all kinds of kelim and mizrakim, different kinds of bowls, gold and silver, that they were told they could have it back, and they took it back to Eretz Yisrael.
So in the whole, with Achashverosh, it was before this?
Achashverosh is before this, yes. The kings that are, I'm sorry, Achashverosh is after this. We're going to say that the seed is going to be a break. There's the kings that are going to be now Dayovish, which we passed that already, and then Koresh.
These are both Persian kings?
Persian kings. Dayovish Hamadi and Koresh HaParsi. Dayovish is the Mede, and Koresh was the Persian. And then Achashverosh was after Koresh. There's another king, Artaxerxes, which we'll see when questionable who he is. There's a king that's called Artaxerxes. And then Dayovish the second, who's called Dayovish HaParsi. And he's the one who gave permission to build the base of Mikdash. But we'll take the story as we go. And so what's bothering you about Achashverosh?
Because they said that he used the kelim from the base of Mikdash.
And according to this, it says that Koresh already had permitted them to take it back.
Yeah.
Very nice question. And I didn't have that. Here it says that he let them take back the kelim, and the Medrash says by Achashverosh that he used the kelim of the base of Mikdash. How could that be? They had already taken it back to Yerushalayim. Very nice question. Thank you. Okay, I'll try to look into it. Perek Bay starts the list of all the people that went up, and it lists families, and it says Zerubbabel was the leader. He was from the family of David, but he wasn't a king or anything. They had no kings anymore. Zedekiah was the last king by the Korban, and now, even though he's from the same family, but he was not a king, but he was the leader. And there's a list of the leaders, about 10 leaders, and then it says the names of all the families, and it lists them out, each family, how many people came under that family name, and it has also the Kohanim and the Levim. There's also families of the Nesinim. Nesinim were people that were back in the days of Yeshua, they were from the city of Gibeon, and they deceived Am Yisrael to think that they were from a faraway land, and they made a treaty with Am Yisrael that they should be on good terms, allies, and Am Yisrael was not allowed to kill them then if they're allies. But really it was a deceit, because really they were from the seven Amim, the seven nations of Eretz Yisrael, and if Am Yisrael would have known, they never would have made a treaty, they would have killed them or told them they could leave.
Treaty by Eretz to the treaty?
So the Gemara says that really they could have, they didn't have to honor it, but because of Chilul Hashem, they were machmir, and they honored it. And that's considered a kiddush, because there shouldn't be a Chilul Hashem, so they went beyond the letter of the law, that people shouldn't say that they made a treaty and they didn't honor it. So they went beyond the letter of the law, and they accepted them. But they did make them to be subservient, and it says that they were water carriers and wood choppers for the Beis HaMikdash, for Am Yisrael. So there are names of families of them also. They kept the lineage separated, that they should know that they can't marry into Am Yisrael. The Gemara says also that they made a knas later on in the days of David not to intermarry with them. And you find always when the Gemara talks about Mamzerim, you're not allowed to marry into Mamzerim, also opposed to Nesinim. Nesinim and Mamzerim together, the Mamzer means a Mamzer of the child of a union of Chayiv Kores. And Nesinim are these families of Gibonim. And they list all of the families. Also there's a B'nai Avdei Shlomo that were like Avadim Kananim Lahore, but they were back in the days of Shlomo Melech, they had power, and they sort of were their own families. And also they came back to Yerushalayim, some families of them. There were also families that weren't able to verify if they were Jewish. There was some question about their lineage, and they also came, but they were labeled as questionable if they're Jewish or not. Obviously, they weren't allowed to marry into the Jewish people. They'd have to marry only amongst themselves. And also, there were some people who weren't able to verify if they were Kohanim. They were definitely Jewish, but they weren't verified as Kohanim. So they were told that they cannot do the Avodah in the Beis HaMikdash until they're able to verify it, and they weren't able to.
And the reunion from the Chav Kares,
yes.
Did that give Mamzerim?
Yes. The child was born from a union of Chav Kares, the child is a Mamzer, or Chav Kares or worse, or something which is Chav Mises Bezdin, a capital punishment, that surely the child is going to be a Mamzer. If it would only be a lav, let's say a negative commandment to have such a union, so then the child is not a Mamzer. But if it's a Chav Kares, so then the child is a Mamzer. That's just a side point. And here the Nesinim, they gave them the same level and like a Mamzer Drabbanan kind of a thing. So the pasuk goes at length, very, very many psukim to list out each family and the people, the amount of people that came from each family. The biggest family, just to mention, B'nai Sina'ah, was 3,630. But you had small ones that were like 40, something like that, 48, something like that. I don't remember the exact numbers, but a very big range. Big families, small families. And the pasuk mentions each family and the amount of people that came up in that aliyah. Altogether, the pasuk sums everybody up and says 42,360. That was the amount of people that came up in this aliyah. That's the first aliyah. We don't know exactly how many remained. It doesn't say explicitly how many remained in Babel. But the Gemara does say criticism of those that didn't come up, they all should have come up. The Midrashim say maybe they plan to come up eventually, that let the first aliyah go up, we'll come back a little bit later, but we're going to see soon. But the Midrash says that then Koresh retracted his permission and they weren't able to go up anymore. So you have to hop around when you have the green light, so don't procrastinate. So it says the number of 42,360. They also had avadim, they had slaves and maidservants, that also was 7,337, plus some singers. The Mefarshim explained that on the way, when they made this aliyah, they did it with song and music. So they had 200 singers on the way that would accompany them as they came up to Eretz Yisrael. It was a joyous occasion. What?
How many?
200. Mishol Rimi, Mishol Rimi Rose. What?
But how many? There's not so many.
You're saying for 50,000 people to have 200 singers. Maybe with musicians and... I don't know. Can't answer more than that. I don't know.
They knew what Simcha was.
Did they say how long it took them?
No. Later on, when the second aliyah, it's going to say that it took 4 months. But here in the first aliyah, it doesn't say when they left and when they arrived. We don't have that information. It also talks about their animals even. How many horses, how many camels, how many donkeys, how many mules. The pasuk lists out the whole aliyah. Why is it necessary to say all the families with all the numbers? It's not clear. But that definitely gives a big cover to those people who came to Eretz Yisrael, that they got special mention of each name of each family for coming to Eretz Yisrael. And then it says when they came to Eretz Yisrael, so they gave donations, the heads of the families and all the families, they gave money to donate to the Beis HaMikdash, and they all settled in the cities. Means if they had come back to the same city, they came back to the same cities that they had once upon a time settled. This is 52 years ago. Some might have even been the same people. They might have lived through the Golos of 52 years, and they came back. There are some people who came back that had originally seen the first Beis HaMikdash, and they lived through the Golos and came back to the second Beis HaMikdash. But some people were born and they were younger, and they came back to the same cities that their parents had settled in.
But there are no Jews in those cities.
But now they came. Now they were coming. The people who came back from Babel, they settled in these cities that their parents had once inhabited. That's the second parak. The third parak says that it came the seventh month and everybody was settled and they made a gathering. They made a big gathering in Yerushalayim. Everybody was in all their cities, and then the seventh month, the first day, it's going to say right away is Rosh Hashanah, the first day of the seventh month, and they got together and they built a Mizbeach. They must have built a Mizbeach a bit earlier because it says that they started bringing their Kabbonas already on Rosh Hashanah. So they must have built a Mizbeach earlier. So this is an interesting thing that it's open pasuk that they did the Avodah, they built a Mizbeach without the Beis HaMikdash. The Beis HaMikdash was not built yet. But the first thing that they did was to build a Mizbeach. And that's halacha, that you're allowed to bring karbanos on the Mizbeach, even if there's no Beis HaMikdash. You can't bring karbanos without a Mizbeach, but if there's a Mizbeach, you can bring karbanos even if there's no Beis HaMikdash. Theoretically, nowadays, if you'd be able to build the Mizbeach, if we know how to, if we'd have all the details of how to make the mizbeach and permission, whatever would be necessary to do, we'd be able to build a mizbeach in the base where it's supposed to be, in the right place. You can't build a mizbeach any place. It has to be dafka in the place where it was supposed to be. Then you could bring karbonos even if there's no base on mikdash. And that's what they did. When they came back, they built a mizbeach right away and they started bringing karbonos. And it says that they started on Rosh Hashanah, and then they did also on Sukkot, and they Korban Tomeh, they started. They wanted. It says that they were scared. Maybe there was possibility that the people are going to be stopped. As we're going to see soon, they were stopped to continue what they wanted to do. But the Mizbeach, they did have. What?
They were scared.
They were scared that it will be stopped by the neighbor. We'll see, either because of the neighbors, or maybe the permission will be retracted. So we're going to see that the neighbors were against them. The people who lived over there, not Jewish, they were... They had a bit eye for all this that was happening, that Am Yisrael was coming back. So they built the Mizbeach right away, and they started the Karbonos, even though the Beis Mikdash was not yet built. And then they started getting materials ready to build the Beis HaMikdash. And they gave money to the masons and to the carpenters and to bring from Lebanon, from Lebanon, over there that was famous for wood, Arzei Lebanon. And they started bringing materials in order to build the Beis HaMikdash.
Wasn't there a period like during Eliyahu HaNavi where they brought Kobonis without...
That was only one time thing. That was an Avera. During the time of the Beis HaMikdash, there's an Avera to bring Kobonis out of the Beis HaMikdash. It's called Shchut Echutz or Ma'ala B'chutz, and it's a Chiv Koras. If someone brings a korban out of the Beis HaMikdash when the Beis HaMikdash is standing, so then it's Chayv Koras. And people did that. And during the whole Book of Kings, it keeps on saying again and again, that even with the good kings, there were two issues going on. One was Avodah Zarah. That was bad. Terrible. And even the people who didn't do Avodah Zarah, they still were bringing korbanos to Hashem outside the Beis HaMikdash, which is also a Chayv Koras. And the pasuk says that the kings were not able to abolish it, even if they were trying to wipe out all the various, but they weren't able to wipe out the bummers. So that was happening. Eliyahu and Har HaKarmel, he himself did it. He did bring a carbon on Har HaKarmel. That was considered Haru HaShah. That was considered an emergency measure. As the Navi said that this is an exception. They brought it one time. He brought a carbon outside the basement of Har HaKarmel in order to show the showdown, to show that the Baal is not to be worshipped. But otherwise, it would be a Chiv Koras. Nowadays, if someone brings a korban out of the Beis HaMikdash, it's Chiv Koras. They built the Mizbeach right away, and now they want to start building the Beis HaMikdash. And this was in the second year, a year after they came, in the second month. And they started Zerubbabel, Yeshua ben Yotzadok. Zerubbabel, we mentioned earlier, was the leader, the Nasi, you can call him. And Yeshua ben Yotzadok was the Kohen Gadol. And they were getting ready, and they got all the Levim ready, and they made them to be the conductors. Some say also the conductors for music, that maybe while they were going to be building, they were also going to be accompanied by music while they were building the Beis HaMikdash. Some say that. Some say it's conductors, like the foremen of the work, the Levim were in charge, Tupshatim and the Pasuk over here, and it says which Levim were appointed to have that job. And it says openly that this part of about the foundation breaking, so to speak, so it says openly that they had Kohanim that were dressed and trumpeters and Levim that had cymbals, and they were using David HaMelech songs in order to lay the foundation of the Beis HaMikdash.
And they
from Tehillim probably. It doesn't say which one, but they were using the songs of David to sing about the founding of the Beis HaMikdash. Mir Moshiach Hanukkah Sabbais. It's not Hanukkah Sabbais. That's the inauguration already when it's built already. But this is laying the foundation. It doesn't say, maybe it has some songs that are not printed in Tehillim. I don't know. But it says that they used the songs that David had composed. And everybody was very happy about the beginning of the foundation of the Beis HaMikdash. They were starting to build the second Beis HaMikdash. And many of the Kohanim and the Levim and the heads had seen the first Beis HaMikdash. And it says that they were crying. So you could say they were crying emotionally to see all that was happening, that they saw the first house, Beis HaMikdash, and it was destroyed, now they're building the second one. Some say that they were, they saw that it didn't have, they foresaw that it's not going to have the grandeur of the first Beis HaMikdash. But maybe the simple shot would be just the emotional,
I think
more simple to learn that it was the emotional upheaval of having seen the first house that when it was built, and then it was destroyed, and now it is being rebuilt again. There was a lot of emotion. People were very happy. The younger people were just shouting for joy, and it says that the crying of the elders who had seen the first Beis HaMikdash, that drowned out the sound of the joy of the younger people.
Well, this is what, 70 years later?
Right, this is by the rebuilding. This is, you can call it 52 years later.
53.
From the destruction. We said that there were two counts of 70. It would be 70 years since the Babylonian Empire.
Right.
But as far as the Beis HaMikdash, it's 52, and now it's 53 years already from the destruction of the first Beis HaMikdash.
So these elders would have been, 65,
right,
70?
Right, something like that. Then Perek Dalet starts, that the neighbors, they called Sarai Yehuda Binyamin, the enemies, the foes of Yehuda and Binyamin, they heard that people came back and wanted to build a Beis HaMikdash, and they approached Zerubbabel and the other leaders, and they said, we want to build together with you. We also are serving Hashem. So these are Shamronim, Kusim, and the Pasuk says earlier in Kings, in Malachim, it says that when Am Yisrael was exiled, so the Sanherib, Melech Ashur, the king of Assyria, he brought Goyim to resettle the land. And over there it says that since they were doing Avodah Zarah, so lions came and were consuming them. And they said, what's happening? Lions never had come here before, but they realized it's because they're doing Avodah Zarah, and they called some Jews to teach them how to serve Hashem. And they weren't true Geirim, converts, because only did it because of the lions. And they says that they were doing both. They were serving Hashem, they were also doing Avodah Zarah. And we see over here that they were not very friendly to us. And they said that they wanted to help us, but Zerubbabel realized that they're not going to be a help, and he pushed them away, and he said, it's not for us to do it together, we'll do it by ourselves. And then they tried to inhibit. They tried to interfere. They used their power to try to interfere with the building of the Beis HaMikdash. And they got counseling, they tried to get advisors and schemes how to stop the building of the Beis HaMikdash, and they wrote a letter to the king. Now, there's an issue over here about who the kings are. We had Koresh, he's the one who gave permission, and then there's Achashverosh, which we know from the story of Purim, who's after Koresh, and there's also somebody called Artaxast, who is a very questionable figure. Some of Farshim, the Gemara says that it's all the same person, but the Farshim explained that this is a drash. The Gemara is going on the drash to Balamor over there in Rosh Hashanah Daf Gimel. He says that the Gemara is a drash, but in Alpi Pshat, there is a person called Artaxast. Besides Koresh and Ayovish, there's another personality called Artaxast. Someone showed me also that in the Persian records of the Persian kings, there is somebody called Artaxast. Besides, what was going to be Achashverosh and Koresh and Ayovish is also an Artaxast. So in the Alpi Pshat, we could learn that there's somebody else called Artaxast. There is a possibility that it's a generic name, the same way you call all the pharaohs, you call them Paro, even though he has his own personal name. The name of Egypt is called, the kings of Egypt, they're called Paro, and you have Plishtim, they're called Avimelech. It could be that the generic name of all the kings of Persia were called Artaxast. But it could be also with somebody's particular name.
But in Vav, I was reading it this morning, it was Daryevish who went to found the original document of Koresh.
Yes.
So why isn't not Daryevish, who was the one who had
You're ahead of us. You're talking about when he's going to get permission. Here we're not there yet. We're talking about now that they're stopping the building. You're holding ahead of us.
Back in Persia.
The Persian kings were in Persia. No, all the Persian kings are in Persia. So, but the question is, who is this one over here? Daryevish you're talking about is the Daryevish II, okay, who's going to get permission to build the Beis HaMikdash 18 years later.
Because he found Koresh as
original
document.
But you're jumping the story. You're jumping the story.
Okay.
So here's talking about that after Koresh had given permission and he started building, so there was some interference and they sent a letter to the king. They sent a letter to the king, Artaxast. The question is, who is he? This also says in one pasuk about in the kingdom of Achashverosh, they made a sitna. They wrote some kind of an offensive letter against Am Yisrael. So it's not clear about when Achashverosh was before Artaxast or after, or it's one and the same. Maybe Artaxast is not a person on his own. So we're just going to read Artaxast without going into who he is exactly. We'll leave it as a question because the Mepharshim themselves are very. It's a lot of confusion about this Artaxast. Later on, we're going to see there might be another Artaxast, which is the Pashup Shat, but after Achashverosh was another Artaxast. And we'll talk about him. So far it says here that in the days of Artaxast, there were people, the names of Misradas, Tobel, and his kahoots, his helpers, that they wrote a letter to the king of Persia, Artaxast, and Avrohom and Shimshah. It says different names who were in on it. And they said, in the name of many nations that lived in Eretz Yisrael, that this nation that has come, the Jews have come back, to Yerushalayim are building a rebellious city and has an old experience, a whole big history of it being rebellious and troublesome. And you should know that if it's going to be built, you're not going to be getting any taxes, they're going to take independence, they're going to become a rebellious city, you're not going to be able to have any power over the whole area, and it's in your best interest that you should stop the building.
Sounds like the United Nations, no? They're called the United Nations.
You should stop the king. The king should stop the permission. So in the Pashup Shat, it's not Koresh anymore. Koresh already died. He's not there anymore. The Gemara says maybe it's Koresh himself who retracted, but the Pashat is not like that. In the simple Pashat, it's a king who succeeded him. His name is Artaxast. And he was warned by the neighboring nations to stop the building because stop building of the city. The Malbim points out that they weren't interested in building the city yet. They just wanted to build a Beis HaMikdash. And they started slandering about the building of the city, as if they want to close the city and make their own government. They weren't even trying to build the city. They were just building the Beis HaMikdash. So he has his own Mahalach over there. The Malbim explains how they were trying to fool the king. Because as we know, in Paras of Mada, you weren't able to retract laws. We know from the story of Purim that you can't retract it. So he talks about over here, how were they able to retract it? Mm. So he says this pshat, how the Malbim has a Malach over here. Just to point out, in the words of the Psukim, that they were trying to build a Beis HaMikdash, they got permission to build a Beis HaMikdash, and they were slandered that they're going to build a city, and they're going to have autonomy, and you're going to lose out control on the whole area, so it's in your best interest to stop the building. Mm-hmm. So the king sent back that I received your letter, and we looked into it, and we decided that you're right, and therefore, make sure that the building stops. Cool. And he gave back authorization to stop the building of the Beis HaMikdash, and they came straight to Yerushalayim, these people who were interfering, and they stopped the building of the Beis HaMikdash until the second year of Dayavesh the
second.
Parsi, Dayavesh the second. So now, we had again, Koresh was the one who gave permission to build the Beis HaMikdash, and then there was Achashverosh in between, who's not so much mentioned over here. There's one mention of him, but not at length. There's a king, maybe Artaxast, who was the one who stopped the building. And then there's another king, Dayavesh. Dayavesh, apparently. The Medrash says that Dayavesh was the son of Achashverosh. Means from Esther. Achashverosh married Esther. And it doesn't say openly in the Psukim, but the Medrash says that he had a son, Dayavesh, and that's this king. Comes out he was Jewish. But he didn't know. He wasn't brought up Jewish, even if he was Jewish by birth. But he was brought up as a Persian king. And he didn't know much about his Judaism. And you don't see, you're going to see he does good things, but not because of his Judaism.
But wouldn't it be Esther trying to influence the situation?
Maybe. But could be she didn't have control. In the simple pshat, we don't see that he's the son of Esther. You don't see anything Jewish about him. Yeah.
No bar mitzvah.
What is that? No, you don't see anything Jewish about him. But he might have, the Medrash says he was Jewish. But in the pasuk, you don't see that. And the pshat is not necessary to see it in the, you don't see that in the psukim. So we're now in the second year of Dayavesh. So the Perek Hay starts that, not that they tried to get permission from the king, but the Nevi'im, the prophets that were amongst them, Haggai and Zechariah, they prophesied that they should start building the Beis HaMikdash without authorization. It's already 18 years, it's been about 18 years that they haven't built the Beis HaMikdash. They were stopped 18 years ago. The Pasuk jumps 18 years, and there was no building. The Navi comes and says that you should start building. Against
18 years, it was a break.
There was a break. There was a Mizbeach. They were bringing Karbonis the whole time, but there was no building for 18 years, even though they had come originally with the plan of building the Beis HaMikdash right away, but they were stopped by the retracting of the King Artaxast, and they didn't. The building was batel. It was stopped for 18 years. And now, in the second year of the Yavesh, the Navi said, start building.
These people that implemented it, who were they?
The people who stopped it?
Yeah.
It says the names over here. It says they were Shomronim, Kusim,
Shomron,
people from Shomron that were not considered Jewish. And the names it says here was somebody Rechum and Shimshai. The Medrash says Shimshai was the son of Haman, the famous Shimshai Safra. That's from here that he might have been the son of Haman. Which as far as the timeline goes, it fits very well that he was the son of Haman. But we don't have other sources. There's no Pasuk doesn't say that. The Medrash says that he was the son of Haman.
And who's
the Navi?
The Navi is going to be Haggai and Zechariah. And there is a book in the book of 12, the Trei Asar, so there are two books, Haggai and Zechariah. And Haggai is a very short Navi, but he talks over there at the Nevuah where he said that you should build a Beis HaMikdash. Mm-hmm. What are you doing? I'm building the Beis HaMikdash. And he reprimands the people. Why are you just sitting? Don't you get the hint? Hashem is giving hints that you should be building the Beis HaMikdash. And he tells them, he urges them on that they should build it. And they started building it because of his word.
But the sons of Haman, weren't they hanged?
Right, so that was 10, but he's not a list of 10. According to this, if Shimshai is the son of Haman, so that's besides the 10. The Midrash says they have many more sons besides those 10.
Although there are 50 more.
The Pasuk only says 10.
Yeah, the 10, yeah, the right.
The Midrash says that there were many more. But according to this Midrash, Shimshai was also one of those that are not mentioned over there. You don't know more about that. In the Pasuk, you don't see that. It just says Shimshai Safra. Shimshai the scribe. So the Perikei starts that Haggai and Zechariah, they prophesied to the Jews that they should start building the Beis HaMikdash.
It was a stub. They wanted to stop it. It was
anti-Semitic. Yeah, yes. You get the anti-Hashem. Sonei Tzion. Sonei Hashem. They were haters of Hashem and the Jews, and they wanted to interfere with the Beis HaMikdash. But they didn't say that. They said that they wanted to stop the building of Yerushalayim, but really their point was to stop the Beis HaMikdash. So they started through Bovel and Yeshua Bar Yatzadik. They started building the Beis HaMikdash, and the words of the Nevi'im were supporting them. But then the governors came. The governor, the Persian governors came and said, what are you doing? You're building an unauthorized building. You're not allowed to do this. But it seems in the pasuk that they weren't as anti, as much as the people that stopped it initially. They're just saying that you're building unauthorized. Not that they had any problem inherently with the building of the Beis HaMikdash. Thus they said that you're not authorized to do this. We'll see as the story unfolds what happened over there. But it says their names, Tatnai. He was the governor of his district, the Persian governor, and also somebody called Sheshar Boznai and other people. And they said, who gave you permission to build these walls? And they wanted the names. They wanted the names of the people that weren't. Who's in charge of you? He asked the Jews, who are the leaders? I guess they gave the names of Zerubbabel and Yeshua and Yeltsadok. They wanted to know the names in order to send to the king that these people are starting to build Beis HaMikdash that's not authorized by you. So the Jews and gave a reply, which the pasuk doesn't say right now, but it's going to say soon in the letter that they sent. And they had a big shout to the Shmaya, a big heavenly help that the governor didn't order them to stop building until they got the answer back. The pashas would have been that he would say stop building until they got the answer back from the king. But he didn't. He let them continue building until the letter is going to go to the Persian king, whose name is Dayovish, and they'll get a letter back. So keep on building until we hear from him. And they sent the letter. The pasuk reads out the letter that they had sent to Dayovish. And they said that we have seen these people that are building this building, and we asked them for their names, and this is what they told us. So in the letter to the king, the reply is reported to us in the letter that they sent to the king Dayovish, and they said that we are the servants of the God of heaven and earth, and this building has been built before, many years ago, by a great king. That's Shlomo Melech had built the Beis HaMikdash. And when our forefathers sinned to Hashem, he gave us over to Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babel, and he destroyed this house, and he exiled the people to Babel. But in the first year of Koresh, the king of Koresh gave permission that it should be rebuilt. He authorized it, and even gave us the kelim, and gave us back the vessels of the Beis HaMikdash that Nebuchadnezzar had confiscated. He brought it back, gave us back to us, and we brought it, Sheshbatzar, the name who was considered the governor, and he gave us permission to build it. So therefore, the king, Dayovish, should check in his records and see that he'll find that we were authorized to build.
So these governors who were not friends of Israel, they sent the spoken word of the Jews.
Right. They were accurate in the response. That this is what we said to them, this is what they said, and please check it out. So the king should check out. The Malbim says that they weren't anti-Semitic. They weren't out to stop it. They just wanted to do their job as a governor.
Accurately.
They were governors. They were responsible. Nice. So
bureaucrats.
They sent the letter. What?
The bureaucrats.
Right. Not because they were inherently against the building of the Beis HaMikdash, that's why they know they're authorized to do it. So they started building it without authorization, and they told the king, look in your documents, in your records, in your chronicles, in your archives, and see that we have permission from Koresh. So Perek Vav, the sixth Perek, it says that Dayavish ordered that they should investigate in the archives, and they found something that was in Madai. And they found a small zikaron, a small record that from the days of Koresh. And it says over there that Koresh gave authorization to build the house in house of Hashem in Yerushalayim, where they bring karbonos. And it says that the dimensions that it should be 60 by 60, amos. And it says that they should make stone, three rows of stone and one of wood. And the expenses should be paid from the king. He said the expenses should be paid from the king. This is the old letter that they found from 18 years ago. And also the kelim of the Beis HaMikdash should be returned, that the Nebuchadnezzar had taken away should be returned to them, and be brought back to Yerushalayim.
Would it be right to give the king the schus of contributing towards the building?
Yes, l'chor. The Gemara talks about that maybe it didn't have a kiyum, it didn't sustain because it had a hand of Yefes. It had a hand of Persia in the building of the Beis HaMikdash. That's maybe why it wasn't sustained. The Gemara says, Moshe Rabbeinu, the Mishkan is forever. It means it wasn't destroyed by Goyim. But since the Goyim had a chelik in this, maybe that's the reason why it didn't have a kiyum. But they are credited for giving money towards the money towards Beis HaMikdash. So therefore the king said that we found this document, and he sent back a letter to the governor that you should not interfere. Let them to build it, and also I'm now instructing that you should help them. And the taxes money that is from that district should be all given to the Beis HaMikdash, whatever they needed. So not only did they not get stopped, they even got help now, and they got it funded, and the king now is giving the tax money to be used for the Beis HaMikdash.
Yeah, it'd be a yid.
And also it says that he donated animals, oxen and rams and sheep, for karbanos to bring to Hashem, and also wheat and salt, wine and oil, whatever the kohanim say that they need, should be given to them on a daily basis. And they should bring these karbanos and daven for the life of the king and his children. It means he had a motive here that they should daven for him. So he brought the karbanos and he said they should daven for his life and the life of his children. And also he said anybody that's going to interfere, so a wood should be taken out of his house and make a gallows, and he should be hung on it, and his house should be made into a dump. They should tear down his house. That was the old punishment of taking down somebody's house. Whoever interferes with his base of Mikdash, he should be killed, and also his house should be destroyed. And Hashem, who resides his name there, should destroy any nation that is going to stop and interfere with the building of the house of Hashem. I, the Yavesh, have given a decree, and it should be executed immediately. So that was the response of the Yavesh, the king. So when the governor, Tatnai, he got this letter back, so they right away, they did whatever they were ordered, and the people of Yehuda were from Matzliach in the support of the Nevi'im, Haggai, and Zechariah, and they built the Beis HaMikdash that was started by Koresh, and then Dayavesh had finished it, and Artaxerxes, we're going to see later, Artaxerxes is going to come later after Dayavesh, and he's going to eventually help to build the walls of Yerushalayim, which is going to be in the book of Nehemiah. And they finished the Beis HaMikdash on the third day of Adar, in the sixth year of Dayavesh. So they started in the second year of Dayavesh, and they finished in the sixth year. It took 4 years to build the Beis HaMikdash. The foundation might have been built already 18 years ago, but it says they did the foundation. It seems like it took time. But the actual building, it seems that it took from the second year of Dayavesh until the sixth year, and in the sixth year of Dayavesh and the third day of Adar, they completed the Beis HaMikdash. And then they made a Chanukah Sabayis. And it says that the Kohanim, Levim, and all of the other people, they made this Chanukah Sabayis with a lot of happiness, and they brought many karbanos. It says the names which karbanos they brought, and they made the Kohanim to be divided in their 24 divisions and the Levim. And then when it came Pesach, which was a bit later, this was the third day of Adar, when it came Pesach, they made a big Yantif of Pesach, and they all became Tohar to be able to bring the karbanos, and they brought the korban as is prescribed in the Torah, Chag HaMatzos for 7 days, and even the other kings, the king of Asher also, another neighboring king, also, even though till now they had been had animosity, they had exiled their 10 tribes like 150 years earlier, but now they were friendly towards Am Yisrael. That is this first six prakim, which is like, you can say half the Sefer, not in the half of the issues of the Sefer, and Ezra has not been on the scene yet, but this was the issue about the first Aliyah, and the building of the Mizbech, and the building of the Beis HaMikdash being interfered, and then 18 years later to be completed.
You see, the second Beis HaMikdash was built much quicker than the first. The first took about 15 years.
I think over there it's 7 years. The first, I think, was took 7 years, but I think so.
And then the second, 4 years.
This took 4 years. Yes.
Much quicker. What happened?
It could be also that the foundation was built right away. It could be it took like another year or two in the beginning before they were stopped. It might have taken time. They might have taken a year over there. It's not clear. When the foundation also probably is a big part of the building that might have taken a year or so. Yeah. Then the Beis HaMikdash was completed in the sixth year of Dayavish. I don't know how much longer he ruled. And then Artaxerxes was the next king. And in his seventh year, Ezra came up. So it'll be a number of years later than the building.
Seven plus, right.
So we'll learn the Pashup Shat that is a different king. And just to point out that the Baal HaMor says so, in Rosh Hashanah Daf Gimel, even though the Gemara says it's the same person, he points out that it's not the Pashup Shat. So in the seventh year of Artaxerxes, Ezra came up. And he was a great, brilliant scholar, and he was very dedicated to teaching the Torah. And the king was very, very good to him. The king Artaxerxes was very good to Ezra. He held him in very high esteem, and also all of the other officers also held him in high esteem, and he gave him permission to make a second aliyah. And that's what's going to happen now. There's going to be a second aliyah coming to Eretz Yisrael from Babel. And he came, he left in the first month, and he arrived in the fifth month. So it was a four-month journey. The Pasuk says that they got together on the first of Nisan, and they arrived in the first of the fifth month, which is the first of Av. So Nisan, Iyar, Sivan, Tammuz, and they arrived in the first day of Av.
And how many years later?
According to the Gemara's Drash, it would be a year after the Beis HaMikdash was built. Without the Gemara's Drash, it'll be at least 7 years later. The Gemara talks about why didn't Ezra come out right away, and the Gemara says because his Rebbe, Baruch Ben Arya, was still living, and he didn't leave him. He didn't leave his Rebbe. And then later on, his Rebbe was too old to travel. And even if they would carry him, he wouldn't be able to travel. So he waited. And then after his Rebbe had died, then he came up to the in this time. And the king, Artaxerxes, gave Ezra a very strong letter of approbation and recommendation and power. And the Pasuk talks about the reads out the letter at length to say that he gave him authorization to take up from his kingdom all the Jews, then Kohanim, Levim, that want to go up to Eretz Yisrael, and he should be in charge of executing the Jewish law. He gave him, he was interested for some reason that the Am Yisrael should do the Jewish laws, they should do the Torah. And also to, he donated things to the Beis HaMikdash, and anybody that wanted to give donations was able to give, plus the Jews and even the Goyim, it's mashma. And it says what he also donated himself to the Beis HaMikdash. And also, that I think it says here that the taxes also were given, also he also gave the taxes that should be given for whatever the needs of the Beis HaMikdash are. I don't find the word right now, but the taxes, but I think it does say over here. If not, it means it was given from the king's treasury. And the Kohanim, Levim, anybody that was involved in the Beis HaMikdash is exempt from taxes. And Ezra had authority to carry out execution of all the laws, and anybody that doesn't listen to him, he has right to capital punishment and for corporal punishment and for confiscating estate and all kinds of afflictions, whatever he sees fit. He had royal authorization to punish whatever he needs to uphold the laws of Hashem and the laws of the king. And then Ezra is talking now in first person, and he says, blessed is Hashem who gave this into the heart of the king, that he should glorify the house of Hashem, and he gave me kind kechesed. He gave me chesed in the eyes of the king and all of the officials, and I was able to gather people, the leaders of the people, to make a second aliyah. And then it lists out the people who came in the second aliyah, perot teferek chesna. It says the people, but this, it doesn't say as length as in the first aliyah. It just says the males. It says families and how many men came. It doesn't say women and children. It could be that since the first count doesn't say over there dafka men, it could be that it includes also women and children. Here it just says men. So it says also the families and how many men were in that family. And it doesn't say a sum total, but here I counted it's approximately 1,500.
So approximately, it's much smaller
than the first aliyah. It could be together with the families, you could add on a couple of more thousand, but it wasn't like the first aliyah. And he gathered them all to a place, to a certain river, Ahava. Ahava is only the way Ashkenazim pronounce it, but it's written Aleph Hey Vav Aleph, not with a vase. It doesn't mean love. Aleph Hey Vav Aleph, the name of a certain river. And they camped over there getting ready to go on the journey to Eretz Yisrael. And they camped for 3 days. And he was contemplating, looking through the people who are coming up with him. And he realized that there are no Levim. No Levim came up in the second Aliyah.
There was no singing.
But besides no singing, there were no Levim. There were no Levim there.
Maybe they all came up the first.
So, then no, it's considered a taina that they didn't come. They did come. It is true. They did, in the first Aliyah, you do have Levim. And the first Aliyah, which was, how many years earlier was this? It depends. If we say that it was, if this was Dayavish, it's the same as Artaxerxes. So it's a year after the Beis HaMikdash was built. So we can count probably about, how do we say? We said that from the first Aliyah was 18 years until the building of the Beis HaMikdash, that's 18. And then, what other calculations do we have here? And then another couple of years. So about, this was in the 70s. According to the Gemara's Cheshbon, it'll be about 25 years after the first Aliyah.
It could be that all the Levim went on the first Aliyah.
But it's not. But the Gemara says, we'll see not. He was very upset that Levim didn't come. The Gemara says, this is not a Gemara, not a Pasuk. The Pasuk says that Ezra made a knas. He made a penalty on the Levim for not wanting to come. And that's why, even though Maaser is supposed to go to the Levi, but he made a knas, and the question with the knas is either it goes only to the Kohen, or it goes also to the Kohanim. So that was a penalty for the Levim because they didn't want to come.
But why should the Levim, that came the first Aliyah, why should they suffer?
True. Maybe because, you're right. But some say it only was for that generation, but that, I don't know those people, but that generation that they didn't come, that's a good question. I don't know the answer. But the Rambam says it doesn't apply anymore. It means nowadays it goes to the Levim the way it's supposed to be. But it is considered a time on the Levim that they didn't come at that time. And he sent to a certain place to a certain powerful person before he left. He realized there are no Levim. And he was very upset about it. So he sent to somebody that he should send Levim. And he got two families of Levim all together. 38 Levim came up. One family of 18, one family of 20, and he got 38 Levim that came up with the second Aliyah. Also in the Sinim, we said in the Sinim also were people who were responsible to work for the Beis HaMikdash, so that was another 220. So now they're ready to go. Now he had told the king Atachshas that Hashem is very, he has spoken to the king, like the king knows about Ezra. He got such a letter of approbation before. And therefore it says that Ezra was scared, was embarrassed to ask the king for a military escort. This was a dangerous journey now. They're going with not so many people, like 1,500 people, and a lot of gold and silver. And there were people who gave donations. He said that anybody who wants to give donations should give, and the king himself gave donations of gold and silver, and they were now taking this up to Jerusalem. Not the original cave. The original cave had gone up already, but people donated gold and silver
from
to the Beis HaMikdash from Babel. And now they're going, and only 1,500. This is not a great big envoy of 50,000 people, and therefore it was dangerous to go.
King was donated?
Artaxerxes. Again, we don't know if he's a Daryavesh or he's a different king called Artaxerxes. We'll call him Artaxerxes. That's what the pasuk calls him. And Ezra says he was embarrassed to ask the king for a military escort because he had told the king that Hashem is good to all those who trust in him, and he is angry at all those that are not loyal to him. So if he asked the king for an escort, he would say, you don't need that. You have Hashem. You're contradicting yourself. The truth is, it's not a contradiction because Hashem wants us to do whatever we could. The issue of bitachon and ishtadlus, that you have to have bitachon, but you have to do ishtadlus. But because the king wouldn't understand, he wasn't able to ask him for that military escort, so he made it tzom, he made a fast day, that they should daven to Hashem to protect them on the way. They shouldn't be harmed by any of the, on the road, on the journey, from any neighboring armies that might start up with them. And they were successful. They left on the 13th of Nisan, they left. So even
that's
though...
That's amazing, huh?
13th of Nisan, right before Pesach. So that's very, it is amazing. Nowadays, you wouldn't think, wait till left. Tomorrow night is going to be B'tikas Chametz already. At the fourth, and they went the 20th of Nisan. They went on the road.
They can't travel on Pesach. There's two days Pesach.
So then they'll stop for those days of Pesach. They'll stop, and then continue traveling on Chol HaMoed, and then continue traveling.
Day.
So they had Pesach on the road. They had only
one day.
Yeah, they had the first day and the seventh day. Surely they did. Yeah, the first day and the seventh day. But maybe they had the Antar Sheni, Suffolk. But they traveled. They went right before Pesach. 2 days before Pesach, they left onto the road. People nowadays will say, wait till after the Chag. But they didn't. They were an emergency. Hashem's giving us permission to go. And they went right away on the 13th of Nisan. Before they left, he gave over the gold and silver, all those Caleb. He gave it over to the certain Kohanim and Levium who were in charge of... Even Tachmitzena, right before Pesach, all Tachmitzena. And they left right before...
Probably don't in case the king
changes his mind, maybe. So they left 13th and the 13th. And they gave the gold and silver that was entrusted to a certain Kohanim and Levium who were in charge of carrying it and bringing it over and giving it over to the Kohanim in the Beis HaMikdash. And he says over there the names of the people who were in charge of the Caleb.
They
fast before they left. Before that, in Babel, before they left.
And they fast on the 14th as well, probably.
No, this was earlier. This was might have been a few days before that. No. The only day they fasted one day probably was the 12th.
But
surely
they
not before.
On the 14th as well.
On the 14th because of the Tanis Bechoros over there.
Yeah.
But this was something else. Okay, so then they says that they left on the 13th of Nisan and they arrived on the first day of Av. And the people who were in charge of giving over the Caleb, they gave it over as in the number, and they weighed it out. Everything was given over to them, and then they bought certain carbonas.
What does that mean?
They gave over all the money that they weren't trusting.
Oh. They take everything with them.
When they weighed it, when they took it, they got it in a weight. This is how much to make sure nothing was missing.
I see.
And they bought carbonas. It says which carbonas they brought, and. Also, they gave over the letters of recommendation to all the governors, the Persian governors, that should know that they have authorization from the Persian king, and they very much elevated them. Them and the Beis HaMikdash became elevated in the eyes of the Persian governors.
Well, and all the gold and everything, had a din of hekdesh?
Yes, for the Beis HaMikdash.
Sure.
It was dedicated to the Beis HaMikdash.
Had to be. It was the real deal. This is the first time in...
I mean, they had it. The first Aliyah also brought Kalim. But this was another donation to the Beis HaMikdash. Both from the king and from the people, and maybe from the Goyim also. The last episode starts now. Two more program left, Perek 9 and Perek 10. And this is an issue that they approached Ezra. According to some of Harshim, it took 4 months later until they approached him. I don't know why it took 4 months. But that was the issue about the foreign woman. That many people had married foreign women.
And in Babel?
Here in Eretz Israel. Ezra came. We said Ezra came later. He's the second Aliyah. But during the time that they had come from the first Aliyah, so this is 25 plus years since the first Aliyah. Yeah. So people had married foreign women.
Really? What?
They lived over there. It says, Kanani, Chiti, Prizi, Yavusi, these are all of the Amori, all of the Gaishan nations over there, plus also Ammon, Moab, and Mitzrayim, the neighboring nations, Ammon and Moab on the Transjordan, and Mitzrayim, down southwest. So they married, it wasn't a barren land at the time, people lived around, and they had connection, and some people married foreign women, and they told Ezra about it.
And they didn't Megaya them.
Right.
Otherwise, it wouldn't be, then it wouldn't
right.
be
then,
okay.
Then it would have been permissible.
Yeah, well,
at least some of them. What?
Maybe Suffolk areas. Maybe.
But it seems not. It seems that that was the problem. And it also, when we learned it, someone pointed out that they didn't just say, okay, so let's convert them. That wasn't that wasn't a conversion for a true conversion. It was just a marriage. So there were the issue. That was the problem. That was the problem. And also, it says that the leaders were at fault. That either they didn't stop it or that they themselves had also taken some foreign wives. Mm. We're going to see the numbers later on. At the end of the book, it's going to say the list of all the blacklist. Before we had the white list of all the people, all the people who came to Yerushalayim, it's then mentioned them by name. It's also going to mention by name all the people who had taken foreign wives. And it comes out over there, we'll see the number. So it wasn't a great, great number, what we would call a great number, but for them it was considered a great number of people that took foreign wives. So when Ezra heard this, so he tore Kriya, he rent his garments, and he pulled out his hair and his beard, and he was sitting in desolation. And people, he was in the base of Mikdash, and people gathered around him, and he was sitting like in desolation. He didn't know what to do. And he was fasting, and he kneeled on his knees, and he spread out his hands to Hashem, and he said, "My God, I am shamed and humiliated to lift my head to you, because our sins are so above our head, and our guilt reaches till the heaven. From the days of our fathers, we've been in guilt till this day, and in our sins, we've been given our kings, Kohanim, have been given into the hands of the Goyim, and sword, and captivity, and loot, and shame. And Hashem is now, you have shown favor to us, and you left a remnant of our people to come back to the Beis HaMikdash and to give us sustenance in our slavery." It means even though we are still under the bondage of the Goyim, but you have shown your countenance upon us to let us come back to Eretz Yisrael, build the Beis HaMikdash. And after all this, we are forsaking your mitzvahs. You commanded us through the Nevi'im that the land you're coming to is full of the abominations of the Goyim, and you should stay away from them. Don't give your daughters to them. Don't take their daughters for yourselves. And don't have a connection with them in order you should be able to merit the land forever. And we haven't done this. Because of our evil deeds, Hashem, you're not doing as bad as we deserve. How could it be that we're thwarting a mitzvah and intermarrying to the nations of the abominations, that Hashem is going to have anger against us without any remnant? Hashem, you are righteous in everything that you do, that you have left us a remnant, and we are not able to stand before you. And he didn't know what to do. Ezra was like at a loss. What are we going to do? And then, the last parak tells now that there was somebody that as he was crying, so people gathered around him, men, women, and children, they all crying together with him, and somebody spoke up. His name was Chanya ben Yechiel, and he said that we have done this Avera, means we, part of Am Yisrael as a whole, have taken foreign women, but there's still hope. We should make a covenant to Hashem that everyone should send away the foreign women with their children.
Wow.
And this is one of the proofs, you might say, that the children also are Goyim. The child goes according to the mother. If the mother is Jewish, the child is Jewish. If the mother is Gentile, the child is Gentile, because here it says they're going to send away the children also. And do it, you're in charge, and we're with you. He says the people are behind you. So you have authority from the king, and you have our backing. So get up and do it.
It's Ezra.
Ezra. He's speaking to Ezra. Shani ben Yechiel is speaking to Ezra. So Ezra got up, and he made all of the officers and the Kohanim and Levim, they all should swear that they're going to be loyal to this movement, to this project. And he got up in front of the Beis HaMikdash. So they're going to make a big assembly. They're going to call everybody to come. Shechaniah ben Yechiel. So not everybody was there. Ezra was informed, the people that were in the Beis HaMikdash, but not the whole nation. So he went to a certain chamber in the Beis HaMikdash, and he was fasting because he was mourning about this rebellion, so to speak. The Pasuk calls it a disloyalty that they had to Hashem. He made a big announcement. Everybody has to come within 3 days. Whoever doesn't come is going to be, all of his estate is going to be confiscated, and he's going to be excommunicated. So everybody has to come. In 3 days, everybody has to come to the base of Yerushalayim. And everybody came. We're going to see this was in Kislev. This was in the ninth month, the 20th of the ninth month. It was winter. And everybody came from Yehuda, Binyamin, they came to Yerushalayim at the 3-day mark. and they were all in the plaza in front of the Beis HaMikdash, and they were, everyone was shuddering because of the issue. There's some big emergency going on, and also that it was pouring rain. It was outdoors. There was no indoor hall to accommodate everybody. So everybody, it was raining, I thought, for everybody. They had a large assembly, I guess 50,000 people, and it was pouring rain.
Wow.
Ezra got up and he said, the people have betrayed Hashem and taken foreign women, and you're adding on to the guilt of Am Yisrael. Admit to Hashem and do His will and separate from these nations and from these foreign women. So the people said all together, yes, we're going to do as you say. But there are many people, a lot of people over here, and it's raining, and we can't stand outside, and it's not a one-day job or 2 days. There's a big issue. It takes time to do all this. So we should appoint people that should be in charge of this project to separate the foreign women. And they should, some people should stay here in Yerushalayim in charge of this committee, a committee to get rid of all of the foreign women. And everyone should be invited from different cities with their leaders of that city, with the people who have transgressed. And they should be forced to send away their wives. So they agreed. It says two people were strong about it, and they made it. So the Pashtun means that there were two people that were enforcing this point, to try to get Ezra to make that we should have this committee. Some say that these two people were against it. The Malbim says they were against the idea. Well, but it's not. But I don't know why he mentions it then. But they were a butthole. Everybody agreed to it, and they did as this plan was, and Ezra separated together with himself other people that should be in charge by name. And they sat on the first day of the 10th month, that would be Shabbat, the first day of Shabbat, to investigate. That's what the committee said. And it took a few months. They were finished by Nisan. So it took Shabbat and Adar, 2 months. It took 2 months. Shabbat, is that true? The first day of the 10th month, 11th month? No, so again, am I making a mistake? Teves, Shabbat, and Adar. From Rosh Chodesh Teves, the first day of the 10th month is Teves. So Teves, Shabbat, and Adar took 3 months to investigate all the people that are taking these foreign women. And then they forced all the people who had taken the foreign women to divorce them, to send them away, them and their children. So it says they forced them.
It seems to be that they'd already agreed.
They agreed as the nation as a whole, but it doesn't mean if it would have been just everyone sent away a wife, so it would have taken 2 minutes. Uh-huh. But it wasn't.
It's going to be a Yechidim that would rebel.
Right, it wasn't an issue. It was the community was against them, and they had to force them. And now the pasuk goes on to list each person by name, and I counted 113. It's 113 out of about 50,000. So it's like less, it's like a quarter of a percent. But that was considered very many. And it lists out each person that had all done this, and the pasuk ends off that these people had taken the foreign women, and some of them had children, and they sent them all away. That's the end of the book of Ezra.
Yeah, but the 113, what? I mean, these ones didn't.
These are the ones who had taken foreign wives, and they were forced to send them away.
Okay, send them away. But why the blacklisting? Like, they come back to tshuva.
Maybe it's considered as a kapara,
the busha,
that their name is mentioned for good.
I don't know if it says that they agreed on their own or they were forced to. It doesn't say, but it says the list of all the people that had been found that they had taken foreign women. And it says, even from the Kohen Gadol's family, it says from the children of the Kohen Gadol, Yeshua ben Yotzadok, that's the famous Medrash talks about Hasir Begadim HaTzoim, one of the Haftorahs, that even the Kohen Gadol's children had taken foreign women.
Wow.
And it has lists of the Kohanim and some Levim, and then other Bnei Yisrael. It has three lists, the Kohanim and the families of the Levim, and then from Bnei Yisrael. And altogether, it comes out about 113, and the pasuk ends off, these had all taken foreign wives, and some of them had children. It's like a quarter of a percent, I think, of the whole nation. But that's considered a big betrayal of the whole issue. And then continues into the book of Nehemiah.
Yes, you
can.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. It's an honor to be able to learn a whole book.